Real Talk with Dr. David Anderson. How in the world are you today? It's Wisdom Wednesday. We're going to talk about the wisdom of accepting criticism. But before that, I've got a special guest. Hold on. Check
Live
it out.
Live from our nation's capital, welcome to Real Talk with Dr. David Anderson. An expert on race, religion, and relationships, Dr. Anderson wants to talk to you. Our phone lines are now open. 888-432-7434. And now, please welcome Dr. David Anderson, your bridge-building voice in the nation's capital.
That's me, your bridge-building voice right here in the nation's capital. How in the world are you today? Well, wherever you are, in your kitchen, in your car, maybe in front of your computer or your smartphone, watching me on my socials, thanks a lot for tuning in. At Anderson Speaks is my handle there. And of course, we have cameras right in the studio. So if you see this handsome gentleman sitting next to me, I'm going to introduce him to you in just a minute as I give you my sideways peace sign. Thanks a lot for tuning in. Facebook Live and Instagram Live. Just go to Facebook and put in Dr. David Anderson. You see my smiling face. Click right there and boom, we can be friends. What do you think about that? And of course, on the most listened to Christian talk station on the East Coast, second in the entire country, WAVA, 105.1 FM, right here out of Arlington, Virginia, covering all of the DMV. That's DC, Maryland, Virginia, parts of West Virginia, and Pennsylvania as well. So thanks a lot for tuning in. If you're new to the show, let me tell you how we roll. First of all, we've got Marriage Mondays, Tough Topic Tuesdays, Wisdom Wednesdays, that's today, Theological Thursdays, and Open Phone In Fridays. Anything you want to talk to me about on Friday is fair game. And then, of course, on Saturdays, we have a special weekend edition for you from 3 to 3:30, so check us out then. Of course, if you're not tired of me by then, because probably I would be, you can always hang out with me at church. Bridgeway Community Church is a church I pastor. Check me out at bridgeway.cc. Now, today I've got Reverend Bomadoro with me. He is the pastor of Walker Memorial Baptist Church in Northwest Washington, D.C. You know, prior to accepting his call as pastor, Reverend Bomadoro served as a youth minister at Walker Memorial, as an associate minister at First Baptist Church of Highland Park in Landover, Maryland, where he was called to the ministry and ordained as an associate minister at Christian Tabernacle Baptist Church in Hamden, Connecticut. Reverend Bomadoro was born and raised in Washington, D.C., and graduated in the Washington, D.C. area, graduated from Archbishop Carroll High School with top honors. He also attended University of Detroit Mercy, where he graduated magna cum laude with a bachelor's in mechanical engineering. He also earned his J.D., his Juris Doctorate, from the University of Maryland School of Law. He then attended Yale Divinity School, where he received a Master's of Divinity degree there and was awarded the Charles S. Mercick Prize for effective public address, especially in preaching. Married to a lovely woman named Portia, and Reverend Bomadoro, welcome to Real Talk.
Thank you, Dr. Anderson. So grateful to be here with you this afternoon.
It's so good to have you with me. And in this first half of the show, I wanted to talk to you about your life, your church, your ministry, and specifically a special conference that's coming up that we want to invite people to. The conference is called Being the Church. Now, before we go into that, I want to make sure to open us up in a word of prayer, as I always do, and give the phone number. And if anybody wants to call and have a conversation with us, they can. But I want to make sure that we commit our time to the Lord. So let's do that. Heavenly Father, thank you for the opportunity to have this kind of connection through technology. We commit today's show to you, as well as the ministry of Walker Memorial Baptist Church and Reverend Bomadoro. We pray, God, that you give us wisdom today. Yes, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Together, everyone said, amen. Well, we'll talk more about the conference, but let's just kind of level set. This is a conference called Being the Church, and anyone is welcome. It's a one-day gathering. Can you tell us a little bit about the vision of this, Reverend Bomadoro?
Yeah, so the Being the Church conference, it came sort of out of the idea and has been spirit-led by the Lord, wanting us to educate and perhaps grow the faith of not only our members in a small congregation and church setting, but also other congregations around us and even around this country. Mm-hmm. The idea of it is to address this question, what it means to be the church, and this society we live in, we're confronting many challenges. What does it mean to be the church? What does it mean for Christians to live according to Jesus Christ in this society that seems to be getting more toxic? And so the idea of this was to bring speakers, nationally renowned speakers, who can help us to have a deeper understanding of what it means not only to be a believer in our own lives, but how to do it in the way of the God envisions through the church. And so that is the idea. There's several other levels I can talk about, but generally speaking, is essentially bringing theological scholarship, right, to the congregational setting, because we believe that you know, our members, those who have been in the faith for a while or even just a short time, can use inspiration by scholars and thought leaders who can talk about critical areas in which will help us in walking out our faith every single day.
And we're going to talk about some of those critical areas, but this conference is a Saturday, so anybody could probably come. It won't affect their work if they work Monday through Friday. Tell us the time of the conference and who's invited to come.
Sure. And the fact that you touched on one day is important. That's part of the vision. Oftentimes we've traveled to conferences. There's several days. There are maybe issues with people getting off of work or perhaps resources to get there. Here's a one-day conference intentionally to make sure that it's accessible to as many people as possible on a Saturday. It starts at 8 a.m. With breakfast as part of the registration, and then we'll have praise and worship starting at 8:45. And then after that, we will go right into the lectures. This is not a preaching conference. It's a lecturing conference. It's a teaching conference where you know, anyone can come and learn just deep spiritual truths, right, about various areas like theology, you know, who is God? Like, what does God mean for us in this particular context of our country and society? Also worship, right? We all worship something. Is what we worship that's important. And so here we're going to talk about that as well. We're also going to talk about leadership, because in a church context, we want to make sure that not only pastors and clergy understand leadership, but that all of us, right, all of us who are seeking to get closer to God and walk out those principles, we're called to be leaders, right, in some way, shape, or form. And then obviously discipleship is another topic about how do you build and grow your relationship with God. And yes, we are converted. Yes, we've all gone through the regeneration, right, and the sanctification process, right? We have to sort of grow our faith. That's in discipleship. And then evangelism, where it's very, very important. We ought to always be thinking about how do we lead other people to Jesus Christ, right? In our homes, right, at work, right, wherever we are, in the mall, just walking on the street, that ought to be at the forefront of our minds. How do I share the good news of Jesus Christ, right? Jesus himself said that he's been anointed to share the good news and proclaim the good news to the poor and to the lost. And so we want to focus on that also at this conference.
Wonderful. 888-432-7434 is our number, live in studio. And Reverend Bomadoro has talked about these five topic areas that you'll be able to learn about: theology, worship, leadership, discipleship, and evangelism. When we get back from our break, we're going to talk about how can you be a part of it? What do you need to do to register? What do you need to do to get in where you fit in? That's what we're talking about. This is Real Talk with Dr. David Anderson. We'll be right back.
Does your church have legal challenges? McCullum & Associates has experience with pastor church relations, administration and organizational issues, church liability and risk management, and real estate matters. This firm understands the legal aspects of the problems, as well as the spiritual implications of those same problems inside and outside the court. Call McCullum & Associates today at 301-864-6070. That's 301-864-6070.
Have you ever driven through neighborhoods and seen beautiful uplights? You know what uplights are? They're when they shine the light on the trees, they shine the light on the house, and it looks absolutely gorgeous. Well, guess what? During the winter months, Laser Landscaping are doing lights for your house. And they're not only doing lights on the outside, they're also doing hearth work. So if you're looking for nice patios and things of that sort, where you walk off the back of your patio and you just see how beautiful it can be in the spring, well, they're doing the work during the winter. So give them a call directly. It's Laser with a Z, laserlandscaping.llc. You can find them at 240-516-4967. Ask for Fidel, Laser Landscaping LLC. Ask for Fidel. Here's the number again, 240-516-4967. And he's zeroing in his company to give special deals today for Bowie, Maryland. That's right, Bowie, Mitchellville, Greenbelt, that area. They have so many folks that are ready to help you with the lighting and the beautifying of your home. So give them a call. It's Laser Landscaping. Ask for Fidel at 240-516-4967.
Welcome back to Real Talk with Dr. David Anderson. For more information about this program or for resources from Dr. Anderson, please visit andersonspeaks.com. To watch on Facebook Live or to view past episodes, visit Dr. Anderson's public figure Facebook page. Just search Dr. David Anderson and click like. You can also watch live on YouTube. Just search for Anderson Speaks, all one word, and make sure to subscribe. Join our text community and receive a free weekly textpiration from Dr. Anderson. Just text the word INSPIRE to 97000. That's INSPIRE to 97000. And now, back to Real Talk with Dr. David Anderson.
That's me, Real Talk with Dr. David Anderson. So if you want my free inspirational text every Friday morning right around 7 a.m., I'll text you. It's a word of inspiration. I like to call it my textpiration. All you got to do is text me the word INSPIRE, I-N-S-P-I-R-E, INSPIRE, one word. Just text it to 97,000. That's 97,000, and you'll be enrolled in my textpiration community just like that. All right, so every Friday morning, free text from Dr. Anderson. How about that? 888-432-7434. If you're just joining us, in the first half of the show, we're talking about the Being the Church Conference, which is going to be on January the 27th. It's a one-day gathering on a Saturday at Walker Memorial Baptist Church. Reverend Bombardero is the pastor there. So let's go to him now. Reverend Bombardero, how long have you been the pastor of this church, and what is Walker Memorial Baptist Church like?
Sure. No. So I'm celebrating my 10th anniversary as of January 1 of this year. It's the 10th anniversary.
Congratulations,
so,
sir.
No, thank you. And so we are thankful to God for bringing us thus far. I think the average pastor's tenure is somewhere between 3 to 7 years, I believe. Mm-hmm. And so the fact that the Lord has allowed us to not only be there as pastor and people, but to grow in these last 10 years. And also in a traditional context, right? The church was founded in 1891, is in the heart of Washington, D.C., one of the oldest churches of Washington, D.C., right. And I'm the 9th pastor there, right? And so we are excited about this celebration, and part of the celebration is the Being the Church one-day conference, right? How to you know, cast ahead, right? To definitely celebrate God for what God has brought us through,
right?
But also to begin to plant vision and seeds for the many, many days ahead.
That's beautiful. You're at 2020 13th Street Northwest. That's Walker Memorial Baptist Church. Now, if people want to come to this conference, what do they need to do?
Sure. Simply just go to walkerbaptistdc.org. And after they go onto that website, there will be a pop-up that they will see the Being the Church One Day Conference, and they could just click register.
Got it.
There are different categories of registration. We want to focus again on being the church. So yes, you have individual registration, which at this point is $150, mm-hmm. but because we want to focus on an emphasis of groups and community and church, and the importance of learning how to operate within the church, we also have discounted rates for groups. So if a leader wants to bring five or more of their members, there's a certain discount they would get off. 10 right. or more, a certain discount they would get off. And we also don't want it to be prohibitive, right? So if it's cost or if someone really wants to come, they can also reach out to our church, right? You can email us at admin@walkerbaptistdc.org, admin@walkerbaptistdc.org, or just call the church, 202-232-1120, and we'll be able to try to help you to make sure you secure your place for the conference. We're excited about what's going to happen. We believe it's sort of a unique experience in that powerful speakers, including yourself, powerful speakers that are going to be there. And we think that it's time to elevate the voice of the church, particularly in all the various things we see going on around us.
Well, you know, and I'm excited to be with you on that day as well. I'll be speaking on the topic of evangelism. There are five topics: theology, worship, leadership, discipleship, and evangelism. And so for my listeners, I would love to meet you. I'd love to see you, shake your hand, and also just be able to invite you to this warm environment where Pastor Bomaduro is going to be overseeing this one-day event. And so individual cost, $150 for the entire day, or a group cost. Maybe you're a pastor or a leader or a department head, and you want to bring 3 to 5 people and say, you know what, let's do a leadership conference together where we can learn about some key things regarding leadership as well as spiritual development. This would be the one-day conference for you. So again, that's walkerbaptistdc.org, walkerbaptistdc.org. If you want to call the church, it's 202, which is a regular D.C. area code exchange, isn't it? 202-232-1120. Is that right, Pastor?
That's correct.
Tell me about what it's like to be a pastor. For those that are listening and they go to churches, right, but they don't often get a chance to hear a pastor talk about what it means to be a pastor. How did you get called to be a pastor?
So the first thing that comes to mind in being a pastor, and again, I'm a young pastor, right? I've only been doing it for 10 years, is a lot of prayer. It takes a lot of prayer, a lot of time with God. It's a very serious responsibility, and it takes a lot of time with ensuring that I'm operating within the Spirit of the Lord, right? So it's not only prayer, but it's commitment to my own daily devotion to make sure that I'm hearing from the Lord as to how to lead the Lord's people. It's exciting to be a pastor. It's creative, right? It's innovative. It is engaging in helping people. When you baptize, we baptized a 12-year-old young man just this past Sunday, and just the amazement of seeing how the Lord is working through a 12-year-old to testify and confess, to believe in his heart and confess with his mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord and Savior. And so it's amazing. It's an amazing experience. And even more importantly, the impact in the community, right? To know that with a leadership team, you can work together to craft, to develop, to bring programs to the community. So at Walker, we do grocery giveaways. We have a College Bound program at our church where we match mentors to mentees. We have a litany of programs to just benefit Walker Memorial Baptist Church community, which is the 13th and U Street area in Washington, D.C. And so it's a lot of responsibility. You have to do all of this administration as well as preaching. And so you burn both ends of the candle. But I really believe, even in reflecting in these 10 years, I am doing exactly what God wants me to do, and I'm exactly where God wants me to be.
No, that's great. That's great. So if somebody can't make the conference, but they're like, you know what, I'd really love to visit the church. I really love this. You know, I want to be in a church. I've been looking for a good church. I need a good leader. I want to come visit this church. What do they need to do? Times of services and things of that sort.
Sure. So we are during the winter months, we have one service, 10:30 a.m. on Sundays.
Okay.
It's in person and online. All of our handles on Facebook, Instagram, even on YouTube, is all Walker Baptist D.C.
Walker Baptist D.C. Let's talk about the conference again. You have different speakers and different topics. You have Reverend Ebony Marshall Thurman. Tell me about her.
Yeah, so Dr. Thurman, and just a level set, is that the idea of this conference is to bring scholars and practitioners, right? Like theology without praxis, you know, I'm not sure that we'll be walking out what Christ wants us to walk out, right? So it's important for that, as someone who went to Yale Divinity School, you sit in some of those classes And you're like, how can I apply this, right? So right. All these speakers are professionals and practitioners and pastors who have also the experience of deploying and also practicing the theology in which they have learned and developed over time. Mm-hmm. And so Dr. Thurman, she is a scholar at Yale Divinity School. She is a theologian, a Black theologian, and she was one of the speakers actually at the Hampton Conference last year in June. And mm-hmm. so she's coming down to talk to us about theology, like what does God mean? Who is God, right? This is where we begin as what it means to be the church.
Gotcha, right? Gotcha. Now that's good. You also have a Reverend Michael Warren Jr. from First Corinthian Baptist Church. Tell us about him.
Yeah, so Dr. Michael Warren, Reverend Warren, he is from Harlem. His church is in Harlem, New York, mm-hmm. And he is a dynamic pastor. He's been at First Corinthians for many years now. In fact, when I spoke to him, he's been pastoring for decades, mm-hmm. and so he is going to focus on worship. Again, I mentioned earlier, the question is not if you're going to worship. Because we all worship something.
Right.
The conference is going to help us to understand that in being the church, we must ensure as best as we can that the receiver of our worship is God, right? The receiver of our worship is Jesus Christ, our Lord. And so Reverend Waldman will help us to understand a worship in the context of being the church.
Very good. And then you also have Reverend Dr. Carol Lynn Patterson from Calvary Baptist Church. Tell us about her.
Yeah, so she's executive pastor at Calvary Baptist Church in Paterson, New Jersey. Uh-huh. Has a history of teaching discipleship courses and helping people to grow in God. Again, we love the moment of conversion. I mean, that is when salvation is yours based on your confession. That's great, but you know, we don't have to necessarily wait until we get to heaven to get salvation. Salvation is also right here. It's, right. It's walking and marching and growing in God. And so Dr. Carol Patterson will help us to also understand how to get deeper in our discipleship.
Very good. And then you have Reverend William Lamar IV from Metropolitan AME Church. Tell us about him.
Yeah, so he, a good friend of mine, he is the pastor of Metropolitan AME, as you indicated. Bill Lamar will focus on leadership. And leadership is critical because we've all heard talk about, you know, churches are closing and some churches didn't survive COVID, which obviously is tragic for many congregations. Right. But the flip side of that is that sometimes churches aren't closing because of the pandemic or because people aren't coming. Sometimes it's leadership. Right. It's leadership. And so we want to also focus on empowering leaders and other believers. Right. Yes. That if you're serving in a church or you're going to a church, but you're not serving, perhaps God is urging us to also get into leadership.
Excellent. And then the last area is evangelism, which you've asked me to speak on that. Why'd you ask me to speak?
Well, first of all, I mean, it's a no-brainer. It's a no-brainer for me and many of the pastors that I speak with and clergy that I'm friends with. Dr. Anderson, just looking at your ministry and the way you've bridged the gap between various people from various backgrounds, right? Bridgeway is an awesome multicultural church. It reminds me even of Howard Thurman and his idea of this multiculturalism and how we can see the love of God and the community of God in this idea. And so, and I believe that you have done that very well. And so who best to talk about evangelism, right? Talking to people across the aisle, whether you're a Democrat or Republican, whether you're Black or white, you know, whether you're a city person or a suburban person, whatever the divide is, God through Jesus Christ can cross that divide. And so you've done an excellent job at doing that. So we thought, who else can we hear from to help us to understand how to do this in our particular context?
Well, how kind of you. I'm looking forward to being at the conference, and I'm looking forward to those of you who are in my listening area to come to the conference. I can't wait to meet you. It's going to be a day of learning and growing, and who knows what the Spirit of God has in store for you. Please go to walkerbaptistdc.org and register today. That's walkerbaptistdc.org. Today I had with me Reverend Bomaduro. I'm so glad that we got to hang out together. Thank you for the work that you're doing in the nation's capital in Washington, D.C. Keep up the good work, my brother.
Thank you, Pastor.
As soon as we get back, we're going to talk about the wisdom of accepting criticism. How do you do that? We need wisdom from God. We'll be right back. It's Real Talk with Dr. David Anderson. Talk with Dr. David Anderson. Welcome to the second half of the program. If you're just joining us, welcome to the show. It's Wisdom Wednesday. Today, we're going to talk about the wisdom of accepting criticism. In the first half of the show, we were visiting with Reverend Bomadero from the Walker Memorial Baptist Church. They got a conference called Being the Church Conference. It's going to happen on January 27th. I'm going to be preaching there, speaking there, teaching there, sharing there, and I'd love to meet you there as well, January 27th in D.C. That's 2020 13th Street, Northwest Washington, D.C. Go to walkerbaptistdc.org. But now we're shifting. We're talking about criticism. How in the world do you accept it? And when have you been on the receiving end of criticism? How did you react? And how did you discern when criticism was fair or unfair? Do you happen to be a critical person? So if you feel like you need to criticize something, you need to like confront something, how do you deal with that? Do you just kind of go in and say, hey, listen, this is where you are wrong. This is where you need to change. Or are you the kind of person that's not going to offer criticism? You're going to say, listen, if somebody asks me my opinion, of course, then I'll share with them my opinion. But if they don't ask, I don't tell. So what kind of personality are you? Are you the, if they don't ask, I don't tell? or you're the kind of person, no, I'm telling anyway, because I want them to get better. I need them to get better. They don't. Maybe they don't know what they're doing, or maybe they do know what they're doing, but the reality is they are in need of some direction. And then what does the Bible have to say about criticism? Well, listen, if you want to give me a call, my lines are now open. My phone number is 888-432-7434. That's 888-43-BRIDGE. By the way, are you married to a critical person? Are you that critical person in the marriage? What about kids? If you have multiple kids, do you have one that's like more critical than the other? Do you have a critical mother? Okay. If you call me, don't say her name. Okay. There you go. But, you know, do you have a critical parent, or maybe you're on the job, you work regularly in a department, and there always happens to be that one critical person on the team, or maybe you have a boss that's critical. Some people don't want any feedback because feedback somehow makes them feel as if they are incapable of somehow being effective. Other people are like, please give me feedback because that'll help me to get better. You know, I have some of my top team people, some of the folk that report directly to me. You know, one gentleman is particularly my COO. He often asks me, he's like, hey, listen, is there anything that you need to say? Is there any way that I can do better? Is there anything that I haven't done well? He's inviting, right, critique. He's inviting feedback from his boss because, A, he's not in some way insecure to hear something that could be helpful, but B, because he really wants to make sure that he knows what's in my mind. Right? Because people can be critical, but they may not ever tell you what that criticism is in their mind. And so you're relating to them every day, but you don't realize that they have critique in their mind about you. And because you haven't asked them or given them permission, they're not verbalizing it. But do you really want to be relating to them? And as they relate to you, they're thinking the same thing of a sort of a critique that they wish you would do better, but they're not saying it. A lot of it has to do with personality. A lot of it has to do with relationship. A lot of it has to do with clear communication. So let's talk about that. Feel free to give me a call. My phone number is 888-43-BRIDGE, 888-432-7434. And today's topic on this Wisdom Wednesday is how to accept criticism and the wisdom of it. And by the way, when does criticism go awry? Like, you're like, you know what? I wish you would have never said that, you know, because really it's not about me. It's about you. Has anybody like ever criticized you, but really the issue is them? So they're criticizing you about their issues, but because of their issues, they just feel like you're going to be thinking the same way. So therefore they project onto you their immorality. They project onto you their insecurity. They project onto you their insufficiencies. They project onto you their lack of capacity. So, of course, they have a lack of capacity, so therefore you're going to have a lack of capacity. So if that's the case, their criticism to you is that the reason why you're trying so hard is because of X, Y, and Z. And they're sort of judging you where the reality is, actually, no, it's not X, Y, and Z. It may have been that for you, but it's not that for me. And so what happens is people tend to project and become critical of you, not because of you, but because of themselves. Well, anybody want to talk about that? Give me a call, 888-43-BRIDGE. I'm running to my commercial break now. My lines are open. When we come back, we'll take your calls. I'll also give you a few tips that you might want to take with you as you think about your relationships. This is Wisdom Wednesday. And this is Real Talk with Dr. David Anderson.
Hey, Have you ever listened to Real Talk with Dr. David Anderson and wondered how we come up with heartfelt discussions on Marriage Mondays or engaging topics on Tough Topic Tuesdays? Well, our listeners are our inspiration. We would love to keep hearing from you. So if you have an idea for the show, let us know, because comprehension begins with conversation. Send us your ideas by sending an email to info@andersonspeaks.com and join the conversation on Real Talk with Dr. David Anderson.
Want more Real Talk with Dr. David Anderson? You can now catch Dr. Anderson's half-hour radio highlight show on Saturdays at 3 p.m. right here on WAVA 105.1. You'll enjoy recent conversations he's had with callers to this show. Real Talk with Dr. David Anderson, Weekend Edition, Saturday, 3 p.m. on WAVA. Check it out. For more information about Dr. Anderson, visit andersonspeaks.com.
Do you need to be encouraged, or do you know someone that needs encouragement? Dr. David Anderson has compiled his sermon series, Be Encouraged, into a book which will be sure to encourage yourself and others. For a donation in any amount, we'll send you a signed copy of the book. To make your donation, visit andersonspeaks.com, click on the donate button, and we'll send you your copy today.
Dr. David Anderson, Scott Anderson, thanks a lot for writing in. Kim, Summer, Kimberly, I see you on my Facebook Live page. And Scott Anderson, question of how much it cost for the conference called Being the Church on January 27th in Washington, D.C. The cost is $150 for an individual and less if you bring a group. So check them out. You can always go to walkerbaptistdc.org. That was the first half of the show where we were talking about a conference I'll be speaking at on evangelism and so many other areas of Christian leadership, theology and discipleship and worship, all that good stuff. So make sure you check that out. Walker Memorial Baptist Church, January the 27th. Our topic now is criticism and the wisdom of accepting criticism. When have you been on the receiving end of criticism, and how did you react? How do you react? Now, when we're talking about criticism, what's very, very important to understand is what is the constitution of the relationship. That's key. The constitution of the relationship. In other words, if somebody criticizes you online and you don't have a relationship with them, don't put energy into it. Don't sit around and obsess. You could have 10 comments that are positive and one that's negative, and you look at that one comment and that ruins your day. You give energy to it. You don't even know that person. They don't even know you. And so you don't want to be governed by negative criticism when there's not a positive relationship. Can I say that again? You don't want to be governed by a negative criticism if it's not a positive relationship. Now, if there's a positive relationship you have with someone and they give you a negative criticism, then you want to pay attention to it. Then you want to try to figure out if the criticism is accurate. What part of the criticism can you actually, learn from and be better? I think that this is how we all get better, you know. And so, like, if you're a single child, let's say you're an only child, you know. No shade here, but if you're only child, you have to have other relationships to help you, because when you have sisters and brothers, there's something that develops when you're growing up in an environment of siblings that takes the rough edges off of your esteem. You know what I mean by that is a brother or sister going to tell you about yourself. They're going to tell you your breath stink. They're going to tell you things about yourself. They're not always trying to coax you and worry about your esteem. The good news is when you've gone through that at a young age, by the time you're an adult, they say it to you in college. Guess what? You're not going to fall apart and crumble, because you've been here. You know, you've been dealing with sort of feedback all your life. But if you are an only child, and you're sheltered in a way where you don't have other people who can really work on those rough edges, you could literally go through your upbringing and never have anybody tell you about yourself, which actually is not a great thing. Now, again, there's other ways to handle that. There's friends, there's cousins. There's some really good things about being an only child, right? Like, you know, people who I know are only child, only children who grew up, they relate to adults so much better. They tend to be so much smarter. They talk and they write better. I mean, there's a lot of positives to it, so don't get me wrong on this. But with this area of criticism, you don't want to be a person that just falls apart and crumbles because you don't have the approval of other people. So I'd love to talk to you about it. If you feel like you want to give me a call, feel free. My lines are open. 888-432-7434. 888-43-BRIDGE. Now, there is a difference also between criticism and approval. I think what happens is if we receive criticism from someone, if we're not careful, we translate that into approval, meaning because they're criticizing me, they must not approve of me. And that's not necessarily true. Remember what I said, the constitution of the relationship is what drives the way you respond and what kind of energy you put into somebody who's saying something critical. We all need feedback. But if I know that the relationship is a positive one, then I'm going to respond and reply to criticism in a different way because I know they're not trying to hurt me. But do not mistranslate or misinterpret someone giving you criticism to someone who's now saying, I don't approve of you. Because a lot of people are living their life for the approval of others. And so therefore, if I need your approval and now you're saying something critical of me, I feel like the relationship is damaged. It's not, because there's a difference between criticism and approval. But if I react because I'm thinking that I'm being rejected as a person, that I'm being critiqued as a character, that you no longer approve of me, then I'm going to respond in a way that it overcompensates. Where all they were simply trying to do is tell you, you know what? You got too many typos because you're typing too fast with your thumbs. And so what I need you to do is read your messages before you press send. That's all. Okay? So all of a sudden, if you have issues with approval, you're like, oh my gosh, they think I'm stupid. No one said you were stupid. They just said you can't write. No, I'm just kidding. So what you need to do is learn how to edit. It's appropriate criticism, but it doesn't necessarily mean it's a character assassination or someone now disapproves of you. If you want to talk about it, give me a call. It's Wisdom Wednesday, 888-432-7434. All right, so the next time you receive feedback from managers or mentors or peers, try following these steps to try to gracefully accept their feedback. All right, so let me give you a few. Number one, pause before reacting. All right, pause before reacting. I think that's important because sometimes our mouth gets ahead of us, right? Anybody been there, right? I've been there. Someone says something, immediately you want to defend. No, pause, listen a little bit more. All right. I think that's the first step. That's one thing that you can do. So when you're given criticism, the first thing you should do is just pause. Pause for a brief moment. That can help you process what you're hearing, what you're being told. It allows you to prevent any reflex reactions or defensiveness. And this also gives you a chance to reclaim your calm and remain calm and be cognizant with your, especially with your facial expressions. All right. So all of that's important. And you can read more of this on the source called Indeed. All right. But that's one. Pause. I think that's good, too, because for me, if I immediately start defending and translating what you're saying, I could actually misinterpret what you're saying, because sometimes you may not use the correct words. So you use some word to try to communicate to me, and that word triggers my thinking. And as a result, I'm now down another path, and you really didn't even mean it that way. So I think pausing is cool. Keeping an open mind is the second thing you can do. And that is, you know what? I'm not going to lock in on this and be offended. What I'm going to do is I'm going to remember that the person who's offering me criticism is likely doing it so that they can help me identify a gap in my work or a way that I can improve and do better. So you have to try to keep an open mind while you're talking to somebody who's trying to speak messages back to you that could actually be helpful. And the reality is it can help you to recognize the validity of their concerns because we can't see ourselves the way other people do. Something called the Johari window. You can always go and Google that. I don't have time to do a whole teaching on it, but this whole idea of a Johari window is that somebody from outside of me can see me in a way I can't see myself. And so there, it's a blind spot, if you will. That's probably a better way to put the Johari window in a very concise definition. It's a blind spot that you don't see, that somebody else can see. And now what they're going to do is they're going to take that from your blind spot or your Johari window, and they're going to put it into sight so you can see it. And you would never even know it unless they told you. So if somebody put a sign on the back of your back with some tape that says, kick me, you don't know it's there. So that's in a Johari window. Or you come out of a bathroom and there's tissue connected to the bottom of your heel and you don't see it, right? But someone else does. Do you want them to tell you have toilet paper tissue stuck to the back of your shoe? Or do you want everyone around you never to tell you anything about you because the way that you respond is not going to be a way that is going to be helpful? So they're like, you know what? I'd rather them have the sign on their back or the tissue on their shoe because I ain't going to tell them. That's actually not a great way to lead. It's not a great way to be in relationship. And so I think when people see that you have an open mind, you don't take yourself too seriously, then they're willing to tell you, you know what? You got something on your nose. All right. That's a good thing. So keep an open mind. Here's a third one. Then I'll start taking your calls. Listen to understand. All right. Listen to understand. So you now want to listen critically. You want to listen what we call naively. You want to really say, try to get under the words that the person is speaking so you truly can understand what they're saying. All right. So there are a few steps. Hopefully it'll help you. It is Wisdom Wednesday and we're trying to drop some wisdom on you. As soon as I get back, we'll take one or two of your calls and then we're going to land this plane. So you better get in where we fit in. This is Real Talk with Dr. David Anderson.
This is Pro Football Hall of Famer and Super Bowl champion Jonathan Ogden, and you're listening to Real Talk with Dr. David Anderson.
That's me. Real Talk with Dr. David Anderson. Listen, we had a good show. You know, the first half, we talked about being the church conference. It's happening on Saturday, January the 27th from 8 to 5 at Walker Memorial Baptist Church. I'll be there teaching at the conference as well. I'd love to meet you. Make sure you check out the conference by going to walkerbaptistdc.org. walkerbaptistdc.org. All right. And the second half of the show, we've been talking about criticism, and I'd love to hear your thoughts on it in just the last couple of minutes of the show. So let me go to Dumfries, Virginia, and talk to Subhan, who's on the line. Hello, Subhan. How are you today?
Hi. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir. I can hear you just fine. What are you thinking?
So I think it's funny that I just randomly turned on the radio station. And I usually don't listen to the station. I'm driving my mom's car.
Okay.
I've been experiencing something like exactly what you're describing with like my fiance. It could be anything small. Like I could say, your laundry's been sitting around the room for like a couple of weeks and you haven't done it. And she'll like take that as me disapproving of her and get really sad and like, oh, do you even love me anymore? I feel like I don't belong here. I feel like I'm being attacked. And I'm like, yeah, no, I'm just letting you know that you should probably do your laundry. like stuff like that.
right. Okay. Yeah. Well, first of all, thank you for calling. I'm glad you found me in your mother's car. And that's good news. So, you know, this is good for you to learn since she's your fiance. The way she's receiving that criticism probably has a lot to do with the way that she grew up. But one of the things you can do is ask her, hey, listen, do you want me to say these things or will you prefer me not to say them? Because I love you no matter what. I never have to say any of this again. I want to hear from you. What is the best way to address this? And let her tell you, because maybe then she'll tell you how to come to her or why she feels a certain way. It could even be your tone, and you don't even know it, because sometimes we have the right words, but we have the wrong tone, or we have the right words, but we have the wrong time. And so they could hear it differently at a different time, but we just chose the wrong time to do it. And so I might just ask her, Subhan, hey, what would be the best way for me to say this, or would you prefer me not to even say it at all? What do you think about that?
That's actually very insightful, because now that you mention it, I did bring it up when she got home from work, and right. She was probably just like trying to relax.
Right. There you go. Well, see, that's why we call it Wisdom Wednesday, Savan, all right?
Yeah.
And make sure when you get to your car, you put on 105.1 FM every day at 3:00 so we can connect again sometime. All right, my friend?
All right. Awesome. Thank you for the advice. I hope you have a nice day.
Hey, you too. God bless you. Well, don't you love radio? You never know who is going to be listening. I pray, Subhan, that God would work a great connection between you and your fiance and God, the one who created the heavens and the earth. And I think he wants you to be married in a way that's in him. If you want to learn more about that and even how you might be able to have a good Christ-filled relationship, email me. info@andersonspeaks.com. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much that you help us grow and develop, even like you're going to do on January 27th at the Being the Church Conference. We pray that you help us to relate and learn together in Jesus' name. Amen and amen.
Help your children